everyone. Hello. Thank you all for coming. I'm dangerously going to deviate from my prepared remarks and tell you that I am just thrilled with the turnout tonight for George Kourounis. So now I'm going to go back to what I have on the paper. Hello, everyone. My name is Caroline Land, and I'm the chair of the adult services team here at EPL, which is the 2014 Library of the Year. I am pleased to welcome you to the first event in our new Forward Thinking Speakers Series. The Forward Thinking Speakers Series reflects EPL's rich history of taking risks, trying new things out, and redefining the modern library. EPL is inviting thought leaders from a variety of industries and around a variety of topics to share their insights, ideas, experiences, and viewpoints, with the goal of helping us purposefully build better organizations, neighborhoods, and communities. Thank you. In October, Sunny Grosso, coaching and culture chief from the Delivering Happiness Group, will join us to talk about inspiring passion and purpose in your organization. In November, EPL will be welcoming Dr. Gabor Maté to talk about compassion and social inclusion. For more information, please stay tuned to epl.ca. Great speakers are just one of the great things happening at EPL. We recently launched two new services to help bring library services outside of our walls. The first is EPL To Go Literacy Vans, which brings EPL's exceptional programs and services to new and underserved communities. The second is Welcome Baby, EPL's partnership with Alberta Health Services to bring essential literacy materials to every child born in our city through the two-month immunization process. These projects won't happen without the support of library lovers like you, and you can learn more about these projects at epl.ca/donate. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, George Kourounis. George is a storm chaser, adventure seeker, and the co-creator of OLN's Angry Planet. He travels to the most dangerous, remote, and inhospitable places on Earth to document the extremes of nature. Curious by nature, George is often pushing the limit of fear and comfort in the name of gaining new insight. And after his presentation, I'd just like to say that there will be an opportunity to have a Q&A session with George. So if he doesn't answer your question during the presentation, there will be a chance afterwards. Please welcome George Kourounis.
All right.
Let's see if I can get this to work. It is an adventure, and it works. Awesome.
Library of the Year.
It's an honor. Thank you. The turnout tonight is just literally overwhelming. I can't believe it. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. Usually when I show up in a city, they're either evacuating or people are heading for the basement. So I really appreciate you guys being brave and sticking it out. So... Literally, you know, when you're a kid, people ask you, what do you want to be when you grow up? And people come up with all these kind of crazy ideas. You know, you want to be an astronaut or you want to be whatever, right? And I have that kind of job description that you think of when you're 7 years old. And I just never grew out of it. Professional adventurer, it says on my business card. And yeah, it's so weird. My mom doesn't understand what I do for a living. But she's got a lot of gray hairs. A lot of gray hairs. I really have to watch because I'm going to end up falling off and I'm going to land in your lap, sir. So just be warned. So tonight, I literally have not even been home. I've been home 3 nights since July 23rd. So a lot of travel. And I just came back from Vanuatu in the South Pacific, where some of you may have seen a viral video that has gone a little bit crazy on the internet of this crazy guy diving into a volcano. Yeah, you're going to see that if you haven't seen it already tonight. Really spectacular. So tonight, what I really want to do is share with you the best of the best. The craziest adventures, the most spectacular places, and some of the most frightening encounters that I've had poking Mother Nature with a stick and then aiming a camera at her. Because that's kind of what I do, right? So it doesn't matter whether it's a hurricane or a tornado or a volcano, avalanches, blizzards, if there's something going on in nature that will probably mess you up, I'm usually not too far away with my camera rolling. So to start things off, I want to give you guys a little bit of a video introduction, because not everybody's familiar with the kind of stuff that I do. So it's like a 3-minute video, and I call it Another Day at the Office. It's basically the past 5 or 6 years of my life compressed into about 3 minutes. Hurricane Sandy. Yes, that's my car. Tornado chasing, mainly across the central United States. Places like Kansas, Nebraska, Texas, Oklahoma. India during the monsoon season. And lots of tornadoes. I've stopped counting how many I've seen now. Tried my hand at ice climbing. This is in Banff. Not very good at it. Timbuktu. Trying to ski on sand. This is the world's largest lake of sulfuric acid. Let's go boating. Australia, India, New Zealand, Iceland, the Yukon, Chernobyl. Spent 3 days in the radioactive zone of Chernobyl. Uzbekistan. This used to be a fishing village, but all the water is now gone. This is the Aral Sea, what used to be the Aral Sea. And of course, volcanoes in the South Pacific, Indonesia, Java, Italy. Sharks. Komodo dragon trying to eat me for lunch. Swimming with piranhas. Losing my lunch in a fighter jet. One of my favorite places in the entire world, the Nika Crystal Cave. I'll be talking about this later. Spectacular. Not very good at dog sledding. Still got a bit of work to do there. And yes, that was a real cobra trying to attack my camera. So that's what it's like when I go to work. Thank you. Thank you. It gets a bit crazy out there, to say the least. And it's funny because I'm a curious guy, and curiosity is a commodity that's in such great, great value. It's such a valuable commodity. People think that love is the opposite of if you fear something or either love it or fear it. But that's not true. You either fear something or you're curious about it. And I just have this this wonderful curiosity. And years ago, I decided that the purpose of my life was to travel the world and document the most extreme places and then share what I've seen with as many people as possible. And I do that through television, through the web, through meeting people firsthand at presentations like this. And it's that guiding philosophy that I try to adhere to every single day that has allowed me to sort of pursue this career. It's not even a career, it's a lifestyle, really. You know, I do this cool stuff and I somehow manage to pay the mortgage. Somehow. And, you know, have a little bit left over for food at the end of the month. Usually spending it on equipment, camera gear, and airfare. But it's all good. And my heroes growing up were guys like Jacques Cousteau. Do you guys remember watching Jacques Cousteau? The ocean world of Jacques Cousteau. Oh, amazing. Brilliant man. Inventor. Invented the scuba diving system so that he could explore this underwater world and brought his camera down and shared this undiscovered place with viewers, millions of viewers around the world. So he was a hero of mine growing up. I had all of his books. I watched all of his shows. My other hero growing up, Indiana Jones. So when you take the science and exploration part of Jacques Cousteau and you combine that with the adventure of Indiana Jones and that adrenaline pumping action, then yeah, you kind of see where those two have come together to sort of lead me in this direction that has taken me. Now, I don't know if you guys noticed, but Indiana Jones is like the worst archaeologist in the world. So maybe not the best role model in terms of professionalism, because every temple that he goes into ends up getting destroyed. So he's not very good at his job, but man, he looks cool doing it. And I didn't get into this adventure sort of lifestyle until much later in life. I started off with, I was a musician. Because being a musician is a cool way to meet girls. Or so they told me. Instead, usually it's the guitar player. I started playing bass, so the bass players don't get the girls. I learned that the hard way. So I ended up switching and taking engineering in school. So I studied engineering, and I started working in recording studios in Toronto. That's where I'm from. That's where I'm based. That's where they send my mail to, anyway. And doing that for many, many years, it was great, but the stress was building up, and I wasn't doing something that I was totally passionate about. And it was eating away, just sort of at the back of my brain, like a splinter in your mind. And I did my very first tornado chase in 1998. And it wasn't that eventful. I went down to Oklahoma, met up with some experienced storm chasers. They took me out for 2 weeks. And I saw my first tornado, but it wasn't very photogenic. It was this dusty sort of swirl on the ground. But it came straight towards us. And we had to put the van in reverse and back into this ditch, and we got stuck for a few seconds, and we finally got out of the way, and the tornado crossed the road right where we had been parked. So, of course, that got me hooked. And I've been going back every year since. And eventually just kept doing it more and more and more and dealing with different phenomena, hurricanes, forest fires, volcanoes, just on my own. I would negotiate extra time off because I loved it so much. It's like, whenever there'd be a hurricane spinning up in the Atlantic, my boss would look at me and say, "Why are you still here? Why aren't you out? And why aren't you down in Florida?" And then I would just take off and go, and I would bank all my overtime, and eventually got to the point where I got my own television series, Angry Planet. And that came about just because I was already doing these things that I love to do. I got a phone call from a producer one day, and he said, "Hey, I read about you in the newspaper. What you do is really cool. We should make a TV show out of it." I said, "Okay, let's try that. Why not?" So we did. We pitched the idea to Discovery Channel. They said, "No." "All right, fine." So we took the idea and we retooled it. It wasn't going to be this one-off special. We decided to change the idea. We'll turn it into a 6-episode series. We'll bring it to the Outdoor Life Network. And we'll change it up so that every episode focuses on a different force of nature. So one of them, episode one, will be blizzards, another episode will be tornadoes, etc. So we brought the idea to them. And after some negotiation back and forth, they came back and said, "You know, we love the idea, but we can't commit to doing 6 episodes. We have to do 13 instead. Let me think about that for a minute. So I had to quit my job at the recording studio and basically just dream up all of these adventures now that I was able to go do. And we made the show from 2006 until 2010. That particular show, Angry Planet. And we filmed it in over 30 countries all over the world on all 7 continents, including Antarctica, which is a beautiful place. There's 2 places everyone needs to go to, Antarctica and Africa. If you've never been to either, save up. It's worth it. It's amazing. So we were filming in, oh geez, all over Africa, in Dubai, India, and just Australia, New Zealand, Tonga, just all over. And after the economic downturn hit, they canceled all their shows, I still kept doing it. Working with different TV networks, doing things for the Weather Network, doing things with Discovery and things like that. So still very active in doing television, and I've got some big news that I wish I could share with you guys, but legally I can't. Let's just say I just got back from Los Angeles and things went well. So that's all I can say, and it's killing me. But it all started with tornado chasing. And I'm sure you've seen this. You've seen the movie Twister, right? A lot of people have seen the movie Twister. And that new one, Into the Storm, just came out not that long ago. And now, geez, how long have I been doing this for? About 16 years, and I've been guiding tornado chasing tours for about 11 years now. So if you want, if you want to come tornado chasing, or if you have a mother-in-law that you'd like me to put in the path of a tornado for you, come see me after the show. Can make some arrangements. So people travel from all over the world, and they come to Oklahoma City, and I pick you up at the airport, and we live like nomads, traveling all over the central United States, putting on about 5,000 miles every 2 weeks, just going wherever the wind takes us. So we'll do our weather forecast in the morning, and I've had to teach myself meteorology. I do not have a meteorology degree. All the meteorology I know, I've learned myself and learned from others, from mentors, from studying, from reading. I don't need to know what the temperature is going to be in Red Deer 2 days from now. I don't care. I need to know where this is going to happen. So I distill all of that meteorological knowledge down into exactly what I need, and that allows me to forecast and sort of predict where these tornadoes happen. Most of them in the central United States. Tornado Alley, right? That area basically from northern Texas up into the Dakotas. They get about 800 tornadoes a year. That's a ton of tornadoes. I would not live down there. I love to visit the place, I really do, but I would not live there. But of course, Tornado Alley does extend up into Canada. If you guys live in Edmonton, you know all about tornadoes, right? 87, right? Absolutely, devastating. But Tornado Alley does extend east, and does go into southern Ontario, where I'm from. We get about a dozen every year. And the prairies get about 50 or 60 in total every year between Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and Alberta. So lots of them here. Nowhere else on earth do you get as many as you do in the central U.S. And it's almost always in the springtime, May and June, right? So if you want to ship that mother-in-law off to me, plan for May. And of course, they come in all different shapes and sizes. These tornadoes, they're nothing but a swirling, violently rotating column of air that's in contact with the ground. And the storms that produce these tornadoes can sometimes be twice the height of Mount Everest. Huge. All concentrating their energy on this one point, hopefully in a farmer's field. Hopefully not in someone's house. This particular tornado, unfortunately, did hit a town of Conway Springs, Kansas. Now, you guys probably know the answer to this. Where do you go if a tornado's coming for your house? Basement. Awesome. Where do you go if you don't have a basement? Neighbor's basement, right? If you don't have a basement, what's the second best place? Storm cellar. Okay, storm cellar. Awesome. Okay, no storm cellar, no basement. You can't get underground. Under a bridge. No, that's a bad idea. Don't go under a bridge because the wind actually accelerates as it gets squeezed. It's like putting your thumb on a water fountain. Don't go under an overpass. It's very dangerous. Bathroom. Yeah, bathroom's a good spot. You've got not too many windows. You've got plumbing. You've got a tub that you can get into. Interior part of the house, right? So if you don't have a basement, that's a pretty good second bet. So there was an elderly woman in this town. Tornado was headed for her. I'm chasing the tornado. I'm watching it go into town, unfortunately. She doesn't have a basement. She decides to go into the bathroom and grab onto the most sturdy thing that she could find. The toilet. So now there's this little old lady, scared out of her mind, of course, clutching onto the toilet. Tornado hits her house, removes the walls, removes the roof, removes the toilet, with her still holding it. And deposits her and the toilet into a nearby tree. She was okay. She was fine. A few scratches, a few bruises, a few fingernail marks in the porcelain, I'm pretty sure. But she was all right. These tornadoes, they do very odd things. I've seen places where a house has been destroyed, but the wine glass is still sitting on the kitchen table. Things like that. And depending upon where you are, in relation to the sun, the tornado will appear different colors. This one was also in Kansas, but it was lit by the sun, so you get that beautiful white cylinder shape. This one was backlit, much larger, this wedge-shaped tornado. This was probably 3/4 of a mile wide, whatever that converts to in metric. Comparable in size to probably what the Edmonton tornado was. And this tornado was on the ground for about 45 minutes. Luckily, it didn't hit anything. We never wish for these tornadoes to hit populated areas. Never do we wish that. But myself, my team, we're all first aid trained. If something does happen and we have to help people, we stop, we put the cameras down, chase is over, and we help. And there's been many times where we've had to do that, unfortunately. Especially in Joplin, Missouri, which got devastated by an EF5 tornado, we had to stop and help with numerous injuries. So luckily, we love to see these touch down in an open field. When they hit an open field, they're not even a natural disaster. It's just a natural phenomena. They only become disasters when they hit stuff that we've built. So we are the deciding factor in what becomes a natural disaster. Sometimes they're slender, segmented. You don't even have to have the funnel all the way reaching the ground for it to be a tornado. It's a column of air, not necessarily a column of cloud. So you can have tornadoes that are invisible. Those are really dangerous. Sometimes you get tornadoes that are wrapped up in rain that you cannot see. Super dangerous. So I try to avoid those like the plague. It's nice when you can see them. You can tell which direction they're moving. After so many years, you can sort of predict what a tornado is going to do. Most of the time. But not all the time. This tornado, which starts here, you can barely see it, and ends over here, was the world record largest tornado ever documented. El Reno, Oklahoma, May 31st last year. It was 4.2 kilometers wide. That's over 2.5 miles. Get in your car, put it in drive, reset the odometer, drive for almost 4.5 kilometers. That's how wide this thing was. Luckily, I was behind it and it was moving away from me. I had my camera on wide angle and it still barely fit in the frame. Unfortunately, some colleagues of mine, Tim Samaras, his son, and another storm chaser, who are very well known as tornado researchers, they work with National Geographic and other agencies, they were on the other side of the tornado. They got hit by it. It was too strong for them to ride it out, and it was too big for them to escape. And unfortunately, they were killed. And it was the first instance ever of a storm chaser that was killed by the storm that they were chasing. And these guys were the best. So much respect for these guys. So it shows you that even though you think you may know everything, Mother Nature is always in charge. What happened here is the tornado went from 1 mile wide to 2.5 miles wide, did a sharp left turn, and accelerated all in the span of 1 minute. So that's how fast things can change. Still want to come tornado chasing with me? There's a few of you, I'm sure. This was a scary day. This was one of the scariest days that we've ever had out there. And it did go into the town of El Reno as well. This is in the Guinness Book of World Records. It wasn't photogenic at all. This particular one in South Dakota was. Oh, wait a minute. Before I get to this, I got a little story. Oh, hey, back up. There we go. So we talked about the best place to be in a tornado, right? In your basement. The worst place is probably in a car. A tornado will take your car, crumple it like a Coke can, and kick it into a field with you in it. So keep that in mind when you watch this video. This is from South Dakota a couple of years ago. Oh. perfect. The tornado is out in the field. It's not affecting anybody.
I got a crazy idea.
That close?
What?
That close?
Yeah. Let's do it.
So now I'm convincing my chase partner to go closer.
What a great tornado. Holy smokes.
We know it's going to cross the road ahead of us. The road that I'm driving on right now. So I'm driving the car.
Long-lived, violent tornado. No sign of letting up.
Second tornado.
We know it's going to pass just behind this little farmhouse. I pull over. When you open the door, the wind is so strong that everything starts getting sucked out of the van. Maps, everything. Now, check this out. Watch for the oncoming headlights. Have you ever been on the highway and seen someone completely oblivious driving along, has no idea what's going on around them? Dum-de-dum-de-dum. Dude, what is wrong with you? Seriously. So I've got a theory. Either the driver was completely oblivious and had no idea the tornado was about to hit him, or he did notice at the last minute and needs a new pair of underwear right about now. So I'm not sure. I'm not sure which, but it has to be one or the other. Now, I did mention the movie Twister, right? That Helen Hunt movie, Bill Paxton. People ask me frequently, have you ever seen flying cows? Because of that great scene in the movie where the cows go flying past and then they go flying past again, right? More cows. I think it was the same cow. So I get that question all the time. We were in Colorado one time. Now, there are no flying cows, but we had this crazy encounter. Beautiful tornado, open field, not hurting anyone. We're ecstatic about this, but it's slowly moving towards us from the west. And baseball-sized hail is coming towards us
that
from the north.
Awesome.
So we're getting sandwiched in between.
Whoa, some big hail.
And you can hear the impact of the hailstones. So we're trying to get out of there. It's time to go. However, you run into a bit of a problem.
Here's our next problem.
A Colorado traffic jam.
We've got cows. We got a tornado on the ground, just off to our southwest, and cows blocking the road. You never know what you're going to find when you're storm chasing.
And they would not move. There's a reason
Come
why you eat these things.
Bessie!
I could roll down the window and pet them.
Oh, this is just too funny.
You'd think they'd be smart enough to at least part so I could
it's
get
like
through.
It's like the running of the bulls. Charles.
Now, we have a tradition amongst tornado chasers. If we witness a tornado later on that
tornado
evening,
on the ground, bulls, it's like
we've
it's
earned
like
the right to eat a nice steak dinner.
This is the most bizarre tornado
The steak dinner was extra delicious this night. I had a nice revenge steak dinner. But I can't blame the cows. They were just trying to do the same thing that I was doing. They wanted to get away from the baseball hail, right? They were not interested in becoming tenderized. Ground beef, so to speak. So the storms themselves that produce the tornadoes, they're beautiful. And we had an encounter earlier this year in Nebraska where, well, we had an encounter with some farm equipment. We had one of these invisible tornadoes I was telling you about. Formed basically on top of us, took one of these farm irrigation systems and threw it into our windshield. And I apologize,
tornado!
The very beginning of this video is a little shaky. Big storm headed for us. We've already spotted one tornado. It's distant, but the storm's coming at us and we need to get out of there.
Ah, gotta get a little... Need a better vantage point.
So I figured, let's drive east. So now the storm is behind us, overtaking us, and you can just barely see a little bit of the edge of this quasi-invisible tornado. But watch what happens to the irrigation equipment. Wait for it.
We're gonna have to let it go. We gotta let it go. We gotta let it go, guys. Back up. Turn into the wind. Turn into the
oops. Like one in a million shot, right? That one piece came down and ended up smacking right into us.
Yeah. Everybody okay?
It happens.
Big, big, big tornado.
And yeah, that got our attention real fast. So, but it didn't damage the body. All it did was damage the windshield and took off the rearview mirror. There wasn't a scratch on the van. Yes. Because it wasn't my van. Rule number one. If you can chase in someone else's vehicle, do it. Don't use your own. The hood of my car looks like a jealous ex-girlfriend took a ball-peen hammer to it. But it's not just tornadoes, hurricanes as well, the largest storms on the planet. They call them typhoons if you're in Japan or Taiwan. They call them tropical cyclones if you live in Australia or the South Pacific. But here in North America, we call them hurricanes. Anyone recognize this one? Katrina. This was Katrina about 12 hours before making landfall on the Gulf Coast. It was a Category 5 storm. Scale only goes to 5. And I was sitting right about here as the storm was moving north in Gulfport, Mississippi. Now, we all know that New Orleans took a bad hit from Katrina. But what you may not know is that it was the weak side of the storm that hit New Orleans, not the strong side. The strong side hit Mississippi, where I was. What happens is the hurricane rotates counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere. So the strongest part where the winds are on the right side of the eye. The eye, of course, is nice and calm, but the right side is where you get the most winds. New Orleans was on the weaker side. So it could have been a lot worse if the storm had taken a bit of a jog to the west and held its strength. Katrina went from a Category 5 down to a 3 just before making landfall. So it actually weakened quite a bit. But it was still devastating, the costliest natural disaster in U.S. history. And this is what it looked like in Gulfport, Mississippi, where I was. The day starts off a little windy. The city's evacuated, basically. And the wind picks up a little bit more. And then the neighbor's house goes flying, the roof goes flying. And it just kept ramping up more and more and more throughout the day. It started in the morning, and it was basically like being in a blender for about 8 hours. And then the wind got really strong. The rain is blowing things up. Pieces of metal flying around like the blades of a helicopter. Avoid these. And then the wind speed here, about 200 kilometers an hour. So imagine driving double highway speed, rolling down the window and sticking your face outside in the rain like a dog. That's what it felt like. And then add to that pieces of glass, gravel, tree branches. And then the storm surge flooding came. This is all seawater. The ocean level rose 10 meters, 28 feet above normal. We were about a half a mile inland, and we still had water almost up to my waist at times. Tremendous damage. You couldn't even see across the road. The waves were so powerful that they lifted a floating casino barge and dumped it into its own parking lot. There were boats, jet skis, and buoys from the harbor in the street. The wind was so strong that I had to crawl across the ground to get from point A to point B. If I were to stand up, I would have been gone. Now, I'm not a big guy. I need to eat a few more cheeseburgers, maybe to anchor myself a little more. Extremely intense. I know, you guys think I'm nuts, don't you? It gets crazier. Here's the thing, is that I'm so passionate. I love doing this. I love doing it. And I learned a long time ago that if you want something that you've never had, you must be willing to do things that you have never done. So I love doing things that I have never done before, and I love even more doing things that no one has ever done before. And there's been a few times where I've done world's firsts and things like that. And that it's a great little nugget that I always keep in my mind, that if you want something you've never had, you must do things that you have never done. So it requires action outside of your comfort zone. And I spend a great deal of time outside of my comfort zone. I've got a much broader comfort zone than most, but yes, I still do get afraid, absolutely, absolutely. When I'm up close to volcanoes, when they're erupting, they can be extremely frightening, very dangerous places. And you'll see some video coming up from my recent volcanic eruption. And I love these things so much that I decided that a volcano would be a really great place to have a wedding ceremony. So I had to convince my girlfriend at the time to marry me on a volcano. So the proposal went something like this. Honey, I got to set the scene. We're at our favorite restaurant. I managed to convince her on her birthday to allow a TV crew to come with us for dinner. Not an easy task. So I'm already in the doghouse to begin with. So we've got two camera operators, we got some lights. Dinner comes, it's very nice. Dessert comes, I get down on one knee. Honey, will you marry me? And she says,
where?
Honey, wrong answer. Honey, will you marry me?
Where?
Honey.
Yes.
Will you marry me?
Sure. Yes.
Sure. Hold back your enthusiasm a little. So you gotta sweeten the pot, right, guys? Especially since you're already in the doghouse. Okay. How do you think? What do you think about the idea of getting married on a beautiful tropical South Pacific island?
Sounds wonderful.
Ah, a little more enthusiasm now. How about on the crater's edge of an exploding volcano? Not so much. Luckily, Michelle said yes to that question faster than she did to the will you marry me question.
Yes.
So that was great. 6 months later, we find ourselves in the South Pacific, climbing the side of Yasser Volcano, and this thing explodes every 5 minutes for the past 800 years. So it's extremely predictable, and that's why I wanted to go to this particular volcano. So we climbed the side. She had her wedding dress on, climbing this volcano. It was ridiculous. I had my tuxedo on, feeling very much like James Bond. And the locals performed the ceremony as the volcano was erupting in the background. So we had this incredible noise and just the ash going up in the air and pieces of lava flying hundreds of meters through the air. It was volatile. It was unpredictable. It was just like marriage itself. And at the very end, just as we're popping the cork on the champagne bottle and the champagne comes out, the volcano has one more big eruption in the background. And it was amazing. And the best part was all the in-laws were back in Toronto. So I got this thing in for in-laws. So it was a fantastic experience and a really dramatic place to have a wedding ceremony. So
where are you getting divorced?
Where am I getting divorced? I've been away for 2 months. I still don't know if my key is going to fit the door when I go home tomorrow. I literally go home tomorrow. So hopefully, she sent me a text message today and there were some X's and O's, so it's good. You know, we'll see what happens. Now, how much time do I have? Oh, okay, we're okay. We're good. My favorite place in the world, favorite place, the Nika Crystal Cave. You saw this in the opening video. It looks like Superman's Fortress of Solitude. Remember that? Totally does. It's in north central Mexico. It was accidentally discovered by silver miners. They were mining for silver about 900 feet below the Earth's surface, and they broke through into a chamber, completely sealed. No one had ever been in there. And what they saw was something that no one had ever seen before. The largest crystals in the world. Some of these are 10 meters long and weigh 55 tons. Bigger, much bigger, like tree trunks, huge. And they're gypsum, same material as in your drywall at home. But they sat in the perfect conditions in very hot mineral-rich water for about 500,000 years. And there's a chamber of magma about 6 kilometers below the cave, and that allowed that heat to cause these the minerals to crystallize, these selenite crystals, in this beautiful, beautiful chamber. The problem is, well, there's a few problems. The big problem is that it's really hot. How hot is a hot day here in Edmonton? Not hot. I know, it's Edmonton, I get it. But 40? You guys get 40? You're missing the minus, right? 35 would be a really hot day, right? Really hot, like heat advisory hot. The air temperature inside the cave is about 52 Celsius with almost 100% humidity. So you have the temperature of the Sahara Desert combined with the humidity of the Amazon jungle. It's so hot that your body can't shed its heat. You sweat, but the humidity is so high that it doesn't evaporate, so you don't get the evaporative cooling. As soon as you walk in the cave, you start to die. Literally. And I'm not joking. As soon as you go in, the clock is ticking. We were able to go inside without special protective suits for about, we were allowed 10 minutes. We stayed in for 12. And we were just completely sapped, just drained of energy. In order to explore the cave in depth, we had to wear these special suits. And the suits are filled with ice. So you've got a vest filled with basically little freezy pops to help keep your body core temperature nice and cool. And then a special breathing apparatus with ice packs inside to a fighter pilot's type mask. And that allows you to breathe this chilled air. So with this special gear, you could go in for maybe 35 or 40 minutes. And it took us 2 years to get permission to go here, and we were allowed to go in for 1 day. And it cost us $15,000. Because it's privately owned by the mining company. Oh, you want to come to our crystal cave? Oh, here's the bill. Oh, you don't want to pay? Fine, go to the other crystal cave. That's okay, the TV network paid for it. Yes. So, very few people get access to this place. It's very, very controlled, very difficult, and it is very much like setting foot on another planet. And it's temporary, because in order to mine for the silver, they have to have these massive pumps that pump the groundwater out. The cave is below the water table. So at some point when the silver runs out, they're going to shut down the mine. When they shut down the mine, they're going to turn off the pumps. When they turn off the pumps, the water level is going to rise back up, and the cave will become flooded again, and we'll never see it. So it was a real treat and privilege to be able to go here and experience this place. It is unreal. When you're inside, every cell in your body is screaming at you to get out because your heart rate is pounding. We had to get medical examinations before going in and coming out every single time, all day long. When you come out, you go to the cool area to chill out and relax. The cool area, by the way, is about 42 Celsius, and you drink about a gallon of Mexican tap water. Oh, it's a charming, charming experience. But it was totally worth it. Amazing. Now, I've got two more things I want to share with you guys tonight. One is an expedition that I did for National Geographic. This was amazing. When you're a guy like me, a photographer, videographer, if you're into science and nature, working with Nat Geo is a dream. And I pitched an idea to them last year about going to the country of Turkmenistan. You probably can't find it on a map. Nobody knows where Turkmenistan is. It's a former Soviet republic. It borders with Iran and Afghanistan. And North Korea gets 3 times the number of visitors every year. Right? So it's a bustling spot. It's a tourist hotspot. And the government there is so messed up that the former president renamed the days of the week after his family members. Seriously. Outlawed beards. Decided that newsreaders on the TV were not allowed to wear makeup, and he had a giant gold statue of himself erected that always turned to face the sun. So that's the kind of government that I was dealing with trying to get permission to go to this place. But why? You're thinking, why would you want to go there? Because of this. A flaming gas crater, the only one of its kind on Earth. They were drilling for natural gas when they hit a sinkhole. The sinkhole formed. And the drilling rig collapsed. This sinkhole is about 100 feet deep, 250 feet across, and it's leaking methane gas. all day long. They were drilling, and of course, when it collapsed, all the gas is leaking, they decided to light it on fire, thinking that it would burn off in a couple of days. That was in 1971. And it's still burning all day. So, and you can get an idea of the scale. Here are people, right? It's massive. And it just burns. It's like the world's biggest bonfire. It's awesome. So I pitched an idea to National Geographic to go here and study this place. But not just study it from the outside. I wanted to become the first person to ever set foot at the bottom. No one's ever done it before. 12 people have been on the moon. One person has been at the bottom of this, to put it into perspective. Now, why? It wasn't just a stunt. I wanted to do it, but the purpose was to go to the bottom and look to see if there was anything living down there. Now, I'm not talking about, like, giraffes, right? Bacteria, extremophile bacteria, microorganisms that somehow survive in the most harsh environments, similar to the ones that we might find on planets outside of our solar system. So if we could find life here, it could give us clues to life on other planets. So my mission was to basically look for alien life here on Earth, inside the bottom of a flaming pit. And it was cool. It was so awesome. There was our campsite. There's nothing stopping you from driving your car right into this thing. If this was in North America, there would be, like, fences, and you'd have to pay a toll, and, you know, there'd be some park ranger with a hat, you know, and a brochure. No, you could literally just hit the gas and go in if you want. Nothing stopping you. And so what we did is we rigged special fire-resistant ropes across the span of the crater. And there's a spot in the middle at the bottom where there's very little flame. So I was able to rappel down wearing a special heat-resistant suit with self-contained air, the whole works. Drop down to the bottom, and that's me. See my, let me zoom in. There's a zoom. So for scale and perspective, let me zoom back out. There we go. So I was able to touch down here where there's no fire, and then take soil samples near these small fires, and then take temperature readings and measurements over by the big fire here. And the entire time I'm tethered to a rope. The way we set it up was that if I became unconscious or if anything happened to me, my team could pull me out, even if I wasn't able to assist them myself. So the really interesting thing was, as I was digging into the ground here, imagine this, so bizarre. You're crouched down, wearing basically a spacesuit, and you're digging into the ground, there's fire everywhere, and it looks like a coliseum of fire. It's not just below you, it's everywhere. And as you're digging in the ground to take these soil samples, fire starts coming out of the new hole that you're digging. All caught on video, amazing. So I was able to do 2 descents down to the bottom for a total of 17 minutes at the bottom. And when you're standing down there, the glow of the fire turns everything orange, and it reminded me so much of when I was a kid, looking at these old photos from the first Mars landers, and that beautiful red planet, the red rocks. And as I was standing down there, it looked so much like those photos when I was a kid. And it was just an incredible experience being there where no one has ever set foot before. The one regret that I have is that I didn't take a few of the rocks and make a little happy face at the bottom before I came out, just to freak out the next people who came along to look in. I really should have done that. Now, I'm sure you're wondering, did we find anything? Oh yeah, we did. I should preface this, is that the whole purpose of doing this was a scientific expedition funded by the National Geographic Society. And we also had a television crew from National Geographic Television. The show was called Die Trying. Now, I petitioned to change the name of the show because I was the guy that was trying. They weren't the ones going inside. But anyway, I was vetoed. And yes, we did find several different species of, or several different types of bacteria at the bottom of this crater. So even though it's hot, full of methane gas, there was still life down there. The kind of life, well, They were not found in the DNA database, so it was actually a new life form that we discovered, several new life forms. But the closest thing that we could find in the DNA database was extremophile bacteria that is found in volcanic vents in places like New Zealand, things like that. So very exotic life forms that live in very, very different types of conditions that, you know, certainly don't support life as we know it as humans. So that was just an amazing expedition. That was in November. I don't know if it has aired in Canada yet. I don't think it has. So watch for it on National Geographic Channel. It has aired in the US, but I'm not sure about here yet. Now, I think I've got time for one more. Yes. The most recent, the craziest video on the internet right now. This was inside Marum Volcano. That's me. Next to the most violently boiling lake of lava in the world. Myself and some colleagues, we literally just came back. My heat suit is in the hotel across the street right now, because I haven't even been home to drop it off yet. We had to rappel 1,200 feet down inside this crater to get to the bottom. It took us about 2 hours to rappel down to the bottom. And then we were able to walk right up to the edge of this violently boiling lava. And it is unbelievably hot. Super hard to get to. Very few people have been down to the bottom of this place. And I'll show you the video here. Oh, before I show you the selfie that went around the world. If you like do a Google search for world's most extreme selfie, this picture comes up. I was down there with my camera, and I just decided to turn it on myself. Take a couple of pictures, and CNN ran with it. All these news agencies just went crazy with the video and the selfie picture, and now people are calling it the craziest or the most extreme selfie ever taken. So I consider that a bit of a compliment. But the video will speak for itself. Check this out. We had to take a chopper to get to the island. It's a very remote island. Beautiful jungle. The island is called Ambrum. It's part of the Vanuatu island chain between Fiji and Australia. Volcanic gas continuously coming up out of the crater. Our campsite, that was home, and here's an idea of how big the crater is. And the mission was to get all the way down. Sam, and then you'll see me wearing the silver suit.
There's still 600 degrees.
I've seen the video 100 times and it still looks like a Hollywood special effect. It really does. And it's just so mesmerizingly beautiful. If you've ever stared into a campfire, Imagine that times 1,000 with this roiling, boiling, churning lake of liquid rock that's only about 50 feet away from you. And you're dangling at the edge of it with one little rope holding you there, waving to your friend with the camera that's over there, looking behind your back every few seconds to make sure that you don't fall in. And some of the dangers there are not what you might think. The lava is, of course, extremely hot, but it's not the main concern. Falling rocks, for sure, the main concern. Huge crater, there could have been a landslide at any moment. The whole place is shaking and just vibrating from the violently churning lava lake. But also the acid rain. It rains there a lot. And the rain passes through the gas cloud, and it picks up the sulfur dioxide from the gas cloud, turns it into very potent acid rain. So it burns your eyes, stings your skin, and corrodes anything metal almost instantly. All the metal parts of my camera, rusted. My heat suit, destroyed from the acid rain. It was just crazy, so very strong. But of course, the heat from the lava as well. There were times when I would put my camera on a rock and then hide behind the rock to sort of shield myself from the heat so I could get the shot. And then I take my camera back and I look and the front of the lens hood is completely melted. It still works though, barely. I've destroyed so many cameras over the years. I have a hard time talking with insurance companies. A real hard time talking with insurance companies. All they have to do is do one little Google search and I'm screwed. But the reason why I do these kind of things is because we spend so much time, especially here in when you live in an urban environment, we go from our air-conditioned house to our air-conditioned car to our air-conditioned office, and we repeat that every single day. And there's such a disconnect between modern life and the natural world that it's my mission to go and show people these wonderful little gems that are out there, these jewels in Mother Nature's crown that most people are never going to get the opportunity to go see because it's either too dangerous or too difficult or just there's so many challenges. But people love to see these things, and I love to bring them to people, to you, to anyone that wants to look. I just love sharing it as much as I love doing it. I want to thank you guys so much. I think I'm almost out of time. I think I am out of time. But we can do some Q&A, right? Thank you guys so much. Okay, show of hands. Who wants to come tornado chasing with me? That's quite a few. Who wants to rappel 1,200 feet into a churning volcano? Oh, quite a few. You guys are awesome. Totally awesome. We got time for some questions. Who got some questions? Yes. Have I ever been seriously injured? No, not once. Safety is my number one priority. Getting the shot a very close second. My producer once dislocated his finger because we were standing on top of a ski hill and he slipped in the snow. And that was the worst injury we've had. I did catch dengue fever though. In the Caribbean, we were doing an expedition to a boiling lake where the water is boiling inside this volcanic crater. And I got bitten by a mosquito, caught dengue fever. It sucks. Don't try it. Yeah.
What is your training routine like, both physical conditioning and also skills? Like you were doing a lot of complex climbing, etc.
Yes. So skill set, right? How do you train to do these kind of things, both physically and technically? Well, I spend a lot of time training, learning from experts. If I don't know something, I'll bring an expert with me who does know, and I'll learn from them. Physical training, I'm blessed with a really good metabolism, like a ferret on speed. So I don't really need to do that much training to sort of stay fit. Especially tornado chasing is tough because you spend like a month and a half sitting in a car driving across the central United States, eating at like Denny's every day. So that's the hardest part. When I'm doing these other things like volcanoes, you're active. But tornado chasing, super tough. Greasy food, bad meals, and lots of sitting. Yeah, terrible. It's the worst. Yeah?
Clearly you drink alcohol.
Not much, actually. I barely drink. What have I asked to do that I've been denied? Oh, geez. Here's the thing.
What's the biggest one that
That I've wanted to do but have not been given permission to do?
Yeah.
Wow. Sometimes it's easier to ask forgiveness than permission.
Will you marry me?
Yeah, I would love to go and rappel down at Kilauea volcano. There's a lake of lava there. There's five places in the world that have lakes of lava. I've been to four out of the five. I've been to Kilauea, but I haven't rappelled down inside the lava lake. It'll never happen because of the park rangers there, and it's a national park, and they're very protective and overprotective. And there's no way they would allow me to do it, and I would love to. The fifth one that I haven't been to is in Antarctica, a place called Mount Erebus. Would love to go there. Working on it. Yeah?
There must be some crusty critics out there that just think you're a daredevil. How do you defend?
How do I defend people saying that I'm just a daredevil? Well, here's the difference. I'm not an adrenaline junkie. Really, I'm not. Really. I don't bungee jump. I've never done it. I don't jump out of airplanes every weekend. The adrenaline rush that I get comes as a byproduct of my passion and desire to document the extremes of nature, right? Because of the subject matter that I go after, there is necessarily a bit of an adrenaline sort of byproduct there, right? Now, some of the things I do, yeah, they're kind of daredevil-ish, absolutely. But if you know what you're doing, then it's not so dangerous, right? If I were to hand over the controls to you for a 747 jumbo jet, and you don't know what you're doing, is that dangerous?
Yeah.
Of course, but if you're a pilot with 15 years experience, is it dangerous? No, because they know what they're doing, right? Most of my critics are people that sit on the couch with a remote control. I say, come on out, come join me. Yeah, right there. Hold on. Yeah. What are my ropes made out of? The ropes that I used in Turkmenistan to go into the fire pit were made out of a material called technora. And it's basically very similar to Kevlar, which is the kind of material that they make bulletproof vests out of. So it was fire resistant, not totally fireproof. We took regular ropes and we took these technora ropes and we put them in the campfire to compare them. And they did much, much better than regular ropes. So I felt confident that was going to be okay as long as I kept them out of the fire. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Hold on. Right there. Yeah. Yeah. Have you ever been in a situation where I thought this is the end?
Yeah.
Oh, you asked the question. I always get this question. Yes. And it had nothing to do with lightning or a tornado or a hurricane. It had to do with a cave that I was at in Kenya. Some of you may have seen the Angry Planet episode. We were in this cave. It's famous for two reasons. Number one, it's the only place in the world where elephants go underground to the back of the cave, complete darkness. They scrape the cave walls with their tusks, and they chew the rocks to get salt in their diet. So we wanted to go and try and document this. But the other reason why the cave is well known is because it has been the epicenter for two outbreaks of Marburg hemorrhagic fever, which is the first cousin of the Ebola virus with the same symptoms. So if you get it, you get a headache, fever, and then your internal organs turn to jello and you bleed them out. Okay? So I thought, let's go here and film a show. So we did. We went there, and I brought with me the world's leading bat biologist who has mapped this cave. The bats are somehow related to the virus. We don't know how the virus gets from the bats to people, but we know the bats are somehow involved. So I've got surgical gloves, coveralls, respirator, eye protection, helmet. We're at the back of the cave. My cameraman turns on his light, and all the bats, thousands of them, freak out. And they all start flying out towards us. And they're scared, so they're emptying their bladders and their bowels as they're flying past us. So we're getting splattered by these bats. I never promised that this wasn't going to be disgusting. There is no disclaimer. And I look over at Don, the bat biologist, and he's managed to catch one of these bats in his hand. And I think, hey, I'm the host of the show. I can do this too. And I got cocky. I got cocky, and it's my own mistake. No one to blame but myself. I step into the stream of bats and I catch one myself. And I go to show the camera. And then I realize I only have my surgical gloves on. I don't have my heavy leather gloves on over top. It bites through my surgical glove into my thumb, and now I don't know if I have a week and a half left to live. That was scary. I didn't know if I was the Walking Dead, if my internal organs were going to turn into Christmas pudding. I'm okay. But it was really scary. Super, super scary. One from this side. Yeah, you. Yep.
He wants to know if you've been in any environments that are more severe than
Have I been in any environments that are more severe than Mars? Wow. That's tough to say. I haven't been to Mars. Yet. Without self-contained air, you probably wouldn't survive on Mars. Maybe a couple of minutes. I've been in places like that. Yeah, if I were to take two steps closer to the lava lake there at that end video, literally two steps closer, dead. So, you know, that close to being just vaporized. So, yeah, that's pretty extreme. Yes, you. Yes. What you got? I'm sorry?
Have you lost anything important in your...
have I lost anything important? Well, I've destroyed a lot of cameras. I have, accidents happen. Perfect safety record, so that's the most important thing. But definitely destroyed a lot of cameras in the process. Yeah.
Have you ever seen a ball lightning?
Ball lightning? Yeah. No, I have never seen ball lightning. I just did a television show for the Science Channel where I was actually talking about ball lightning. And just recently, last year, in China, some researchers videotaped with a high-speed camera what they believe is ball lightning. I got a spectrum graph of it. So it's very, very interesting. But no, I have not seen it myself. I wish I have. Yeah. How about you? Yes. Bring it on. What you got, buddy?
I've seen an F5 before.
Have I seen an F5? Yes. That very large 4.2-kilometer wide tornado was measured with F5 winds. Over 400 and some odd kilometers per hour.
Yeah.
Yeah, scary. You gonna come storm chasing with me?
Yeah.
Can you reach the pedals? Because I need a driver.
Yeah, when I get older.
Then when you get older, all right, buddy, cool. You're hired, man. I like that kid, he's awesome. Yeah. Yeah. No, when I was in a hurricane, have any of my crew been severely hurt? No. No. Safety first. Safety first and third. Safety, get the shot, safety. Doesn't always work to plan. Yeah.
I understand that you said that you were working on that geo-education work with OLN.
Yes.
Does that cover all of your expenses? Because like you said, you have to spread a lot of cameras and they're not exactly cheap.
Cameras are not cheap. Yeah, that's right. It really does depend on what I'm doing. I'm freelance. I work for myself. I have to sort of loan myself out to whoever wants to pay. So it's basically the toughest part of my job is convincing other people to pay me money so that I can do cool stuff. And sometimes I'm successful, and sometimes I have to fund it myself and try and make the money back afterwards. Like this volcano expedition recently, that I totally self-funded that because I wanted to do it. The opportunity came up, right? I get the TV shows because I already do this stuff. Right? So sometimes yes, sometimes no. It depends on who I'm working with. Like this mystery project I'm talking about?
Yes.
I wish I could share. Stupid lawyers. Yes? What does it smell like around the volcanoes? Yeah. Sulfur dioxide is a very potent gas, and it smells very much like when you strike a match. And it stings your eyes, it burns your lungs. If you don't wear a respirator, you're going to be coughing, and it's just awful. It just destroys your lungs. Yes. Volcanoes that have more hydrogen sulfide gas have that rotten egg smell. So different volcanoes smell differently. And when I go and I start smelling these aromas, I love it. Because that's when I know that adventure is close at hand. How much time do we have, Caroline?
5 minutes.
5 minutes? Oh, we got lots. Yeah, way at the back. That was probably on Ukraine. That was Chernobyl. We spent 3 days inside the radioactive zone at Chernobyl, and that is like being in a zombie apocalypse movie. The city of Pripyat was abandoned in 1986? 86, within 36 hours of the reactor explosion, right? And it's just left the way it was. So we were able to walk around the abandoned city. Everything is radioactive, so you can't touch anything. But you go into the hospital, and there's medical records strewn all over the place. There's pictures of Stalin up on the wall, because it was Soviet era at the time. You go to the maternity ward, and there's rusting cribs with radioactive paint peeling off the walls. You're expecting a pack of zombies to come around the corner. There's an amusement park, completely abandoned, with bumper cars, Ferris wheel, the works, that was just abandoned and left. And there's this bizarre green moss that's growing up around everything. And you don't want to touch anything. And when you go to leave, they scan you, make sure you're not taking anything radioactive out with you, don't have any dust or anything on your shoes. So anyone could go there. It's a simple two-step process, ask and pay, which is the way most things work in this world. But it's fascinating. And as a photographer, it's amazing to go there. It's just stunning, stunning. What else we got? Yeah, in the red. Yes, I didn't rappel quite into the lava. Let's get that straight. Close to the lava.
But can you talk about the setup? Because I don't imagine you arrive and it's just ropes to rappel down.
Right, exactly. So when I showed up at that volcano, here it actually worked out really, really well for me. And don't tell this story, because I could get in trouble. Some friends of mine from New Zealand, who are very experienced at this volcano, had already been there for a couple of weeks, camped out at the top. And they had been guiding a BBC film crew. So the TV presenter from BBC was able to rappel 100 meters down into the crater, and then she got scared. So the campsite was already set up. A helicopter was going to go and pick them up. My friend called me and said, hey, we've got this opportunity. You can piggyback on the back of BBC's expenses. You can ride their helicopter out when it comes to pick them up. So I said, yeah, let me think about that for a second. Done. So I dropped everything, flew to the South Pacific, got on BBC's helicopter, flew out, and literally the ropes were set up when I arrived because they had already been rigged for the BBC. So I was able to get down to the bottom of that volcano with a fraction of the cost and effort that it would have cost me if I were to go and do it sort of on my own without, I'm not going to say stealing, without piggybacking on the back of the BBC's expenses. Yes. Well, they didn't, but my friends, who are very experienced at that volcano, were commissioned by BBC to facilitate them going to the bottom. BBC weren't able to make it to the bottom. I show up, and within 6 hours of me showing up, I'm already at the bottom.
And so then they just leave it there? Somebody else
could. The ropes, well, they were expecting me to come, my friends who set up the rope. So they were expecting me. I show up. Hey, guys, how's it going? I haven't seen you in a long time. Oh, the ropes are all set up. Cool. I put my harness on.
Oh,
no. No. You don't want to leave that stuff lying around because some dude's going to show up and just go, oh. No. So we pulled everything up, struck the camp, everything. We had our porters from the local village take everything down. The helicopter came and took us. We left the site exactly the way we found it. Nothing is left behind. Yeah, absolutely. Way at the back. Yeah.
Two.
One. Yes. What am I? Lawyers? Next. Can I get life insurance? It's funny because whenever I go and talk at a school, and when I talk with adults, they always ask the same, different questions, but it's always the same. Adults always ask about insurance. Kids always ask, where do you go to the bathroom? To answer your insurance question, yes, I can get insurance. For the National Geographic Flaming Gas Crater Expedition, I was required to have specific insurance. And the only company I could get the insurance through was Lloyd's of London. And it cost me about 15% of my expedition budget just for the insurance, which I never used. What can you do? Yeah. You hope to never use it, right?
Have you ever been directly inside a tornado?
Have I ever been directly inside a tornado? Yes. And it sucks. It's like being in a swarm of bees with just debris flying around everywhere. Very, very scary. It happened to me many years ago, just outside of Oklahoma City. And it was at night, tornado hits me. I had to drive with the wind to reduce the impact force of all the debris hitting me and hide behind a shopping mall. And there were power flashes of hydro lines exploding right beside my car. Scary. It took 10 minutes for my leg to stop shaking. And then I kept chasing it. Yeah. I think we got time for maybe one more, or what's our? There's lots of hands and no one telling me to stop, so I'm just gonna keep going. Yeah, we're good. Okay, hold on. You asked a question. Yeah, go ahead. radioactive lake. No, tell me more about this radioactive lake you speak of. I'm actually planning, I can't even talk about it. There's a mystery project that may or may not take me to Russia at some point, maybe within the next year or so. However, I'll check it out. I'll Google radioactive Russian lake. That's probably pretty specific enough. Yeah.
Okay, so you're an engineer working.
Yes. That's a really good question. I've always been enamored with nature, always, from when I was a kid. And I spent so much time living in downtown Toronto, just away from nature. And the movie Twister came out, and it sort of tickled a few brain cells. And I found out about this friend of mine, now he's a friend of mine, who was offering to take people with him to go try tornado chasing. And I thought, you know what? I work way too hard. I'm going to try this. I'm going to take my vacation. I'm going to go try it. And that was the real hook. And I've been going back every year since. So there was that. And Hurricane Katrina was the real event that sort of swung the pendulum in the direction of where I am now. Yeah. Oh, three more questions? Okay. Have I ever thought of going to Pakistan? Yeah, I would love to. I would love to go up into the mountains or there for during monsoon. Or absolutely, would love to. Why not yet? There's about 220 countries, and I've been to many of them, but anywhere where there isn't a pin on my map is where I want to go next. Been to India several times, but not Pakistan yet. Yes?
What does your mother think of
you? Oh, jeez. Next question. What do you think my mom thinks of my job? Let's put it this way. I haven't talked to my mom since that volcano video came out, and it's been viral all over the world. I'm afraid to call. I know my sister has seen it, but I don't think my mom... Well, yeah, my mom's probably seen it, so I'll get an earful. Okay, last question. It's all yours.
Have you worked with, certain
technology? Yeah, what types of technology?
Yeah, what types of
stuff? All kinds of things. Crazy stuff. I worked with a geophysicist from Germany. We brought a Doppler radar to a lake of lava in Ethiopia back in 2005, and we had to cart it up on camels. So you got this super high-tech Doppler radar on the back of a camel going up the side of a volcano and trying to scan the surface of the lava lake. Now, I haven't talked to him in a while. He's kind of hard to reach right now. He's currently on board the International Space Station. Circling right above us right now. His name is Alexander Gerst. Check out his Twitter feed. It's awesome. Beautiful Northern Lights pictures from above. So all different types of technology, from the new materials technology that I was using in the Crater of Fire to satellite and radar technology, all kinds of different things. You name it, I'll try it. I'm a very technical guy. I used to be the technical manager of the largest recording studio complex in Canada. So I love tech, bring it on, and I think we're out of time, aren't we? Thank you guys so much. It's been an absolute pleasure. Absolute pleasure. I will be hanging around outside after, so if you want to come and ask me some questions, or if you want to get your picture taken or anything, I'll be just hanging out and just come see me.
Yeah, let's give George a round of applause. I just want to thank George for coming and giving us this amazing presentation here tonight. And I want to thank everyone who came out so we could share this presentation together. This has been an amazing start to our Forward Thinking Speakers series. Keep in mind, we have more great speakers coming up this fall. Check epl.ca for any information, and you can also follow us on Twitter and Facebook. So we look forward to seeing you at the next speaker series. Thank you for coming.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Excellent audience. These guys are great. Super cool.